Thank you very much for the invitation. It's an honor to be invited to speak on this subject at this place. It's an honor to be asked to reconsider the subject of civil society, which it seems to me a quarter century after the revolutions of 1989, a quarter century after the end of the Soviet Union, is a subject which is worth reconsidering. One of the things which we now know is that civil society is not automatic. If anyone thought that history came to an end in 1989, or that liberalism and democracy were forces in themselves, there's been plenty of time to reconsider that opinion. It's simply not the case that history ends. It's simply not the case that liberalism and democracy are somehow self-sustaining forces which can maintain themselves against adversity automatically. There's nothing automatic in history. There's always the unexpected. There's always the initiative from the individual. And there are always these historical turning points when it makes sense to stop, to readjust, to recalibrate, to rethink. And I believe that we are at one of these historical turning points, and I appreciate your coming to think with me a bit for the next 45 minutes or so about what this historical turning point might be. So, as I said, I think this is an occasion to rethink civil society. The term civil society can become a slogan. It can become a stereotype. Nobody's really against civil society, right? And at the moment when something becomes a stereotype, when it becomes a phrase that we use without thinking, that's also precisely the moment to think about it. Because if civil society is to exist in any meaningful sense, it has to be something which is itself a bit unpredictable, a bit vivid, something which is authentic. And with that word authenticity, I want to recall the name Václav Havel. And this is one of the particular reasons why I'm so glad to be speaking about this subject today. As you will all know better than me, it was Havel's considerations in the 1970s which led many people in Czechoslovakia, in Poland, and beyond, in my country as well, to think about what civil society might be. That there is something, some form of right, some form of activity, which is not reduced to the individual. That there is some form of rights, some form of activity that is not reduced to the state. That there's something between the individual and the state which is worth thinking about, which is worth considering, which has something to do with contacts between individuals, something to do with authentic individual choices. Now, all of that said, in practice, what does that really mean? And in practice, what does it mean in free societies now? And in practice, what does it mean when there are free societies confronted with a challenge from societies that are ever less free? That's our subject today. And for this subject, we have a case study. We have an extremely important, extremely urgent, and extremely interesting case study, which is the interaction between Russia and Ukraine in the last 15 or 16 months. That is the situation that has developed between Russia and Ukraine, inside Russia and inside Ukraine, roughly since October of 2013. Now, as you will all know, I'm speaking to you at a time of an active conventional war in Europe, right? So there are other things you could be thinking about besides coming to lectures in university, right? There's a war in Europe going on. The regular Russian army is engaging the regular Ukrainian army, not so very far from here. The largest tank battles since the Second World War have taken place in Europe. We're not paying that much attention to this, and one of our subjects is going to be why we don't pay that much attention to this. But what the point I'm trying to press home is that this is indeed a critical moment to be considering what civil society means. Which reminds me, one of the many things which is not automatic is memory. When civil society seemed to be triumphing in 1989, we had the impression, even as we thought that history ended, that we had hold of important historical turning points, that we all knew, for example, what 1938 meant, right? What Munich meant, right? Right? What the Zdrada v Mnichově, what it meant. People had a sense that they thought they knew what 1938 meant, or 1939, or 1945, or 1968. It's my sense that one of the things that is slipping away from us is that confidence in historical knowledge. One of the things that is happening or has happened in the last 25 years as we've moved away from 1989, as we've embraced the toxic and foolish belief that history might come to an end, that democracy and liberalism might triumph automatically, that the market's all that matters, etc. As we've embraced these beliefs, one of the things that has slipped away from us is confidence about history. And I think the crisis that we're in now shows how important history actually is. And for these reasons, among many others, I was grateful for the kind words from my colleague, Professor Zubov, who was one of the people, in case you didn't know it, who recalled the significance of the year 1938 to a Russian and to a European public, which wasn't paying that much attention and paid a certain human price for that. So with that said, I want to begin this consideration of the last year and a half, by reviewing just a few crucial turning points in Russian and Ukrainian history, or in the common history that Russia and Ukraine are now debating, disputing, in some sense tragically fighting about. Because it seems to me that this is that history has to be something more. And I'll return to this at the end, that history has to be something more than a playing field in which everyone can say whatever they want, and the person is right, is the person who turns out to be right is the person who has the largest television network, right? History has to be something beyond that. History has to have some kind of integrity, some sort of rules. And in a way, I think this is another lesson that this conflict has reminded us of. So the common Russian-Ukrainian history begins at around the same time and around the same way that Czech history begins, that all the Slavic histories begin. It begins with a competitive attempt by Eastern and Western Rite Christians to convert a pagan ruler. In the case of Kiev and the Rus, which is one of the most very interesting entity, in the case of Kiev and the Rus, in the 10th century, the entity in question was basically a synthesis of Vikings and Turkic peoples who had recently converted to Judaism. This is worth remembering. It's Vikings and Jews, and both the Ukrainians and the Russians say that it was them. So, like, to keep it all in perspective, this is an odd myth of origin, just like, you know, with apologies, your myth of origin is also very odd, and all of the myths of origin are very odd. The difference, of course, being that this idea of Volodymyr's conversion in 966, or Vladimir's conversion, if you happen to be Russian, is something that people are now fighting and dying for, right? So it's important precisely when people are fighting and dying, believing that what they're doing has something to do with 966, that we have some perspective and some distance on events like 966. Another turning point in Russian, I'm making this very telegraphic and very brief, but another turning point in Russian and Ukrainian history, if you like, would be the year 1569. Now, 1569 is not a turning point in Czech history, so let me just tell you why it's important. In 1569, a larger entity was established called the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, which included basically the territory of the Baltic states, Poland, Belarus, Ukraine, and a fair amount of Russia. I mention this symbolically just because it suggests a certain difference between Ukrainian and Russian history. Within the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, cities like Chernihiv or Kiev experienced all of the stereotypical stages of European history. That is to say, there was a Renaissance, there was a Reformation, there was a Counter-Reformation. All of these things, of course, played out a bit differently in this Orthodox part of the world, but they all happened. And that is a difference between, let's say, Kiev and Moscow, right? We can't say Petersburg because it didn't exist, between Kiev and Moscow. And a difference which I think remains significant symbolically. The final date in my very brief trip through Ukrainian and Russian history, trying to establish what the differences and the similarities are, both in reality and in symbolism, would be the period between 1922 and 1923. The establishment of the Soviet Union through to the first five-year plan. Now, the Soviet Union is obviously a big important category which holds Russian and Ukrainian history together. Why? Because there has never been a Russian national state, right? Until 1991, there was no Russian national state. There was a Russian Empire. There was the Soviet Union. There has never been, with the exception of a few months here and there, there's never been a Ukrainian national state either, right? Ukraine and Russia throughout the 20th century experienced history in some important ways together inside the Soviet Union. So the establishment of the Soviet Union in 1922 is an extremely important turning point. Within that memory of the Soviet Union, which is extremely important for both sides, there is a difference, and it's a difference which existed in 1991, as I had occasion to notice, and still exists today. And that is in the evaluation of Stalin's first five-year plan. Now, that may seem like a very abstract thing to mention. What is the first five-year plan? Why can a five-year plan possibly matter? Isn't state planning irrelevant? The first five-year plan was the economic revolution inside the Soviet Union. It was Stalin's second revolution. It was the most important thing probably to happen in the Soviet Union, with the possible exception of the Second World War. It was, without a question, the most important internal Soviet policy. The idea was to transform the Soviet Union from an agrarian country into a modern industrial power. And in order to do this, agriculture, which was largely private in some parts of the country, was turned over to the state in the form of collective farms. As this happened, in general, the people who lived in more productive parts of the Soviet Union, southern Russia, Ukraine, suffered famine. And in particular, in the Ukrainian case, political measures were taken which ensured that this famine yielded several million more deaths than it had to. Now, that is a very important difference in memory, both in the sort of normal sense of transmission of memory down through the generations, as well as in political memory between Russia and Ukraine. Because essentially, all of the territories in today's Ukraine, except for the far west, experienced famine to some extent or another. Where experiencing famine means someone in your family died, someone in your family committed cannibalism. If you survived, you might have committed cannibalism. You saw terrible things happen. The whole traditional village structure broke down. Everyone who survived ended up on a collective farm, right? So it was a massive transition in social mores, in social life. It was a massive humiliation, right, as well. And importantly for our subject, it was also the destruction of traditional civil society. Because think what you like of villages in the countryside, right? There is a certain set of norms which prevail in villages in the countryside. This was all destroyed, and it was replaced by something which actively opposed civil society in any form. Okay, so the 1922 to 1933 is a difference in Russia and Ukraine, because in Russia, although I would emphasize this, there was a good deal of famine and starvation in Russia as well. It wasn't over the entire territory, so it doesn't form the central element of national memory in either senses of the word. Now, this brings us, in our very quick tour through Russian-Ukrainian history, to the current moment, where I'm going to be spending most of my time. But I want to stress something interesting about the current moment before I leave you behind. This history of the Soviet Union, as I said, in many ways binds Ukraine and Russia together, right? The history of the Second World War, in particular, the idea of the Second World War as a struggle between fascism and anti-fascism is something which actually binds most Ukrainians and most Russians together, or until very recently had done so. The Ukrainian history is a bit more complicated than Russian, but in general, for the vast majority of Ukrainian families, the memory of the Second World War is very similar than the Russian memory. And until very, very recently, this was something which held Russians and Ukrainians together. What has changed, and note this because this is interesting, what has changed is not that Ukrainians and Russians think about the Second World War differently now. What has changed is that the Second World War remains the only active reservoir of political memory in the Russian Federation, right? So everything that happens in the world today is still about fascism and anti-fascism, right? The bad guys are still the fascists. In Ukraine, what has happened is that new experiences have overlain and have overcome that traditional memory. So it's not as though people in Ukraine don't care about the Second World War anymore. right? What has happened, though, is that the experience of the last 15 or 16 months of revolution, counter-revolution, and foreign invasion, and a war of defense on their own territory has overwhelmed the memories of the Second World War. Or to put it very simply, something has happened, right? Something intense has happened, and that intense experience has pushed aside the memory of the Second World War and provided a different political myth for Ukrainians. Now, this is important in and of itself, but it's also important when we're trying to get straight what the difference or the similarities are between Ukraine and Russia. I happen to think that this is now the most important difference between Ukraine and Russia, that Russia has not experienced anything like this. The Russian experience of Ukraine is limited hugely by propaganda and by what soldiers say when they come back, if they come back, right? Several thousand Russians have already been killed in action in Ukraine, as I'm sure you know. But it's limited. It's very much constrained. It hasn't affected the entire country. Whereas in Ukraine, it has affected pretty much the entire country. So when people ask what the difference between Ukraine and Russia is, you know, very often we talk about concepts which I think are rather silly, like ethnicity and language. These things don't really, either they don't exist or they don't matter, right? Language does not determine national identity. If it did, you know, then I could just be Canadian and have better health insurance, right? The world doesn't work that way. So ethnicity is a very fluid and questionable concept. What matters is political experience and political commitment. And in Russia and Ukraine in this way are more different, right, than pretty much any other pair of European countries you could care to name. Okay, so thank you. So what has actually happened then in the last few months that is so important that I'm stressing it so much? Let me give you a brief sense of why I think the revolution in Ukraine or the experience on the Maidan in Kyiv was so important. The form of politics that has been dominant in Ukraine for basically the entire time Ukraine exists is something you could call oligarchical pluralism. Right, there are a clan of people in Ukraine who, you know, when conversation with them, you don't call them oligarchs, but like when you're safely away in Prague, you might, even though this is being recorded. And that enforces a certain kind of pluralism. Because each clan has not only their own businesses and their own political interests, they often have their own intellectual agendas, right? Including historical memory agendas. So there's a certain kind of pluralism in a Ukrainian discussion. The problem with oligarchical pluralism, I realize it sounds great and you're thinking, wait, where's our oligarchical pluralist candidate? I have an answer for you to that question. But the problem with oligarchy is the rule of law, right? Because when clans have divided everything amongst themselves and the entire system is corrupt, then no one has an interest in the rule of law. And if you're a small or medium-sized businessman or just somebody who wants a fair deal in general, you hit a ceiling very quickly, right? And that is what the Maidan was all about. I mean, the Maidan was basically a middle class, it was a revolution of the Russian-speaking Kievan middle class, right? Above all, the Russian-speaking Kievan middle class against oligarchy. Okay, there were a lot of Ukrainian speakers as well, but the essence of it and where it began and the language which was most often spoken, just by the way, you know, ethnicity doesn't matter, Russian language doesn't matter, that's all a myth, was Russian. Okay, but so it was about Europe. Now, why was it about Europe? You've gotten used to Europe, you've grown up in Europe, you take it for granted, right? So you can just sleep for the next 5 minutes. But the reason why Europe is significant, was significant for the Czech Republic, as for Slovakia too, not so long ago, is the reason why it's significant for Ukraine today. And that is the rule of law, right? If your main problem is you don't have the rule of law, you associate the European Union with the rule of law, right? It's a classical sort of middle class aspiration. If the rules can somehow be imposed, then we'll all do better, our children will do better, and so on. So Europe, the reason why people were willing to go out on the streets for Europe in Ukraine in late November 2013 was not that they love, you know, Brussels so much or that they've memorized the acquis communautaire. It is that Brussels is nice, actually. It wasn't meant to be a laugh line. It is that for them, Europe symbolized a fair deal, the rule of law, a social contract, something that they have trouble getting in their own country, right? So the meaning of the revolution was anti-oligarchical. The meaning of it was, I think, fundamentally bourgeois. It turned when violence was used. And again, this should resonate in Czechoslovak history. The revolution turned when violence ruled. As, I mean, as you will all remember, the Slovak version of Charter 77 was called the Public Against Violence. Beating students on the 30th of November 2013 really upset people, right? Beating students, the use of violence by the regime upset people and moved the public towards revolution. The first death was very upsetting. One death in early 2014 changed public opinion dramatically, right? Which is, now we're thousands of deaths later. So it's worth remembering that one death to your normal inhabitant of Kyiv seemed like something unacceptable at the time, right? Which is worth remembering when we think about concepts of civil society and decency, right? So the revolution turned in January and February of 2014. The ways in which it had to do with civil society, you know, why I think the Maidan has something to do with civil society, you've already grasped the obvious one, that it's people acting somewhere between their own individual interests and the state. But there are some more interesting levels which I think are worth contemplating. The first has to do with predictability. Right? So if you think about your relationship to the state, I mean, what you generally want, I mean, I realize my anarchist friends are here and they're going to disagree, but what you generally want from the state is predictability. You want the state to follow its own rules. If it doesn't follow its own rules, you generally get upset, right? And one logic of civil society might be this. If the state is not predictable, then society has the right not to be predictable as well. Right, that there's a deal on both sides. This is written into the American Declaration of Independence, by the way, which is probably why I think of it. But the society has a right to be unpredictable when authorities are not predictable. The other thing which is interesting about this, as far as civil society, is the variety of it, right? So people try and will continue to try to reduce this event to some kind of ethnic outburst or some nonsense like that. But of course, you know, as many of you will know, it was started by a young journalist of Afghan origin, right, whose parents were Muslim. The first person killed was a Belarusian, right, the second was an Armenian. During the mass shootings of February, a Russian was killed, many Jews were killed, a Pole was killed. Why am I mentioning all these people who aren't Ukrainian by ethnicity? Because Ukraine is a multi-ethnic country and because the Maidan was a multi-ethnic event. It didn't have anything to do with ethnicity. In that sense, it's civil society because it was a political choice taken with individual existential risk, right? So past a certain point, anyone who went out there knew that they might die, right? And they were choosing to take that risk as individuals, not as, you know, ethnic Ukrainians or ethnic Russians or ethnic Poles or ethnic Jews. They were choosing to take that risk as part of this political movement and as individuals. That's my understanding. So what did this lead to? Well, at the simplest level, it led to some very predictable things. The government was overturned. There were parliamentary elections. There were presidential elections. There was a new government. That all sounds fine. And it would be fine, except for the other thing that it led to, which was a progressive Russian invasion of Ukraine. Now, from the point of view of civil society, this might seem like a more complicated subject, and it is, but it's extremely interesting to consider this war, not just as a war, but as a conflict which I think has quite specifically civil society as its target, right? In other words, when we think of this as a Russian-Ukrainian war, I mean, if we think of it as at all, which I fear many of us don't, but if we think of it as a Russian-Ukrainian war, I think we're limiting the scales. I think we're limiting the stakes. I think the stakes are much bigger than that. The stakes have much to do with political thought and with models of society and what kinds of society are acceptable. Okay, let me try to defend that. It seems to me that, so the first thing we have to know is that the Ukrainian model of politics, this oligarchical pluralism, did not prevail in Russia. In Russia, there prevailed a presidential centralist model in which there are oligarchs, but for the most part, they make up one clique, which is underneath the president. So you're in a very different kind. You're in a very different kind of political system. From the point of view of that political system, oligarchy in Ukraine is okay, provided your own oligarch is in charge. Right? Because oligarchs in general, I mean, again, I'm going to get in trouble, right? But oligarchs in general are not incredibly adventurous people in foreign policy. So if you have the right oligarch in charge, as I would submit, you know, Viktor Yanukovych was, if you have the right oligarch in charge, then from a Russian point of view, you're relatively okay. Oligarchical pluralism is okay for you, provided the right people are in charge. A rebellion against oligarchical pluralism is a kind of double threat. Because on the one hand, And this is how it was experienced in Moscow. On the one hand, you might lose your oligarch, you know, which is inconvenient. You know, you spent so much time, like he's not good company, you know, his Russian isn't that good. You've spent all this time cultivating him, right? Putin doesn't personally like him, and yet, you know, you've like spent all this time with him. And so it's inconvenient to lose your oligarch. But the other reason why it's objectionable is this civil society business, right? Because civil society could be turned against oligarchical pluralism, but civil society could also be turned against presidential centralism. And Kyiv is a very bad place for civil society to break out because, as I've already emphasized, it's a post-Soviet country which has lots of things in common with Russia, one of which is that Russian is the dominant spoken language, right? So it's a troubling place for civil society to break out, hence part of the Russian reaction. But the key element of the Russian reaction, which I think is sometimes overlooked, has to do with Europe. So I don't know how many of you, you know, took the great pleasure that I took in following Russian television in the weeks before and during the Maidan. And I stress the before because the direction that Russian television took before the Maidan, as well as during the Maidan, was strikingly anti-European. Something happened in Russian foreign policy. Something clicked in Russian foreign policy somewhere in the late summer or the early fall of 2013, coinciding with the formation of this entity called the Eurasian Union, which was meant to be a rival of the European Union. And with that came the campaign, which I hope you're familiar with, of Europeans as decadent, right? Which means that Russia has actually preserved European civilization, whereas, you know, all Europeans are basically gay latte drinkers, right? Which, admittedly, you know, sorry, I just had an American moment, right? the key word in this, and the frightening word in this, the key word in all this is decadence, right? Because when you say decadence, you might just think, you know, a fat Roman emperor reclining and being fed grapes in some 17th century painting. But what decadence actually means is you're coming to an end. Decadence means decay, right? It means disintegration, it means the end, right? So the Maidan happened at a time when Russian propaganda and even Russian foreign policy began to talk about the end of Europe or the destruction of Europe, the self-destruction of Europe. And then interestingly, the propaganda about the Maidan was largely about Europe, right? It was about Swedish pedophilia and Polish imperialism, the Swedish-Polish, you know, renewing the 17th century Great Northern War. It was about Europe. It was about nefarious Europe. It wasn't so much about Ukraine at first. It was mostly about Europe. So the Maidan at first was called the Euromaidan, right? Euromaidan. And then in the Russian version of that, which is sort of untranslatable, was, you know, well, I'll just say it in English, the gay Euromaidan. Like, the idea was that it was all gay. And then there was also the idea it was fascist, and then it was both gay and fascist, which is interesting. Okay, if this is new to you, you are not watching enough Russian television. But the point is that we think of the Maidan as a Russian-Ukrainian clash, but I think that really misses the point. It took place at a time when Russia was tilting against Europe. And I think everything that happens vis-a-vis Ukraine has to be understood in the larger European context. And I think Europeans, and by this I mean, you know, you as well, are missing the point when you think of it as a Russian-European conflict, because it's not. It's a test case, or it's part of a larger Russian-European conflict, which has something to do with civil society, as I hope I'll have a chance to explain. Okay, so what is so interesting about this war with respect to civil society? What's interesting about this war is the way that it has been fought. I'm just going to very quickly characterize three things about this war, which I think are interesting, you know, and from the point of view of Russian tactics, very intelligent, very, very effective, but certainly worth noting, you know, worth respecting, right? Worth respecting for their effectiveness, worth appreciating, and worth noting. The first tactic that is something I would call, reverse asymmetrical warfare. So asymmetrical warfare, guerrilla warfare, partisan warfare, is what you do when you're weak, right? You don't put insignia on your uniforms, you mix in with the civilians, you try to bring down retaliations on civilian populations on purpose, because then they will join you, right? That those partisan techniques. Interestingly, that's how the Russian army has fought this war, right? No insignia on the uniforms, mixing in with civilian population, deliberately drawing fire on Donetsk, Luhansk, now Mariupol, in order to get the civilians upset at the Ukrainian government. So normally you do this when you're weak, right? Russia is doing this even though it's strong. I mean, compared to Ukraine, it's very strong. And one of the things which is interesting about all this, well, I mean, it allows them to deny they're fighting a war and allows us to say, oh yes, you're not fighting a war, right, if we want to. But the other thing which is interesting about this is that in a certain way, it's consistent with the Russian view of what's going on. Because the Russian view of what's going on, and I'm gonna talk more about this, is that Ukraine doesn't really exist. It's just a projection, you know, of some kind of American conspiracy. And if you believe that, then Russia is in the weaker position, and it's perfectly legitimate for Russia to break all the laws of war, right? Because they are partisans. They're fighting this great American world conspiracy. So of course they should break all the rules, because they're the weak party, right? And this is how they've played it. And a lot of people, interestingly, believe this, that Russia is somehow like in the subaltern position because they're facing off against the great American hegemon. You know, when in fact they're facing off against the Ukrainian army, which, with all due respect, is a very different thing. Okay, the second thing which is interesting about the Russian approach, which is worth noting and respecting and appreciating, is at the level of strategy. And I guess I've already hinted at it. They're pursuing something which I would call strategic relativism. This isn't the name of their doctrine. I'm hoping that they'll plagiarize it for me, because I think it's true. Strategic relativism: when you recognize the objective limits of your own power, and there are objective limits to Russian power, technological, demographic, economic, dependence on hydrocarbon exports. When you recognize the limits of your own power, how do you be strong? How do you become strong? You become strong by weakening other people. Right? And how do you weaken other people? Well, by making them fall apart. So the reason that Russia is so weak compared to Europe is, I hate to sound like a propagandist for Brussels, but the reason that it's so weak compared to Europe is that Europe is united, right? Russia compared to any one European state is actually quite strong. For various reasons, even Germany, it has certain advantages. But compared to the European Union, it's a tiny economy, right? Exports at the level of the Netherlands, you know, whole GDP about the size of France. It's a small country compared to the whole EU. The whole EU, by the way, has a common energy policy and will probably continue to develop a common energy policy so long as it exists. Individual nation states, it's not so clear. And that's very important for Russia, because Russia's dependent upon hydrocarbon exports precisely to Europe. So naturally, the way you fight the European Union is that you try to make it fall apart, right? Hence, you talk about its decadence, right? Hence, your propaganda line is that it's falling apart by itself. But what you actually do is you try to make it fall apart. And I would submit that at the same time that Russia is fighting a war in Ukraine, against Ukraine, against Ukrainian armed forces, it is carrying out tactics or carrying out policies which are meant to weaken the European Union. The most obvious of these is the support of the European far right, right? If any of you who still are thinking of Russia as an anti-fascist country would do well to check to see who Russia invited to observe the referendum in Crimea and the referenda in Donbass and Luhansk, because these were largely fascists, occasional populists, occasional members of respectable political parties who I'm sure just got on the wrong plane by accident from this country. But in general, they were neo-fascists, right? A few members of the extreme left, if you consider Die Linke the extreme left. But in general, they were neo-fascists, right? And this is part of a larger general trend in which President Putin has more or less openly proclaimed himself the leader of the European populist and far right. Why does he do this? Does he have convictions of this kind? I doubt it. He does this because the populist right and the far right have something in common with him, which is that they want to bring it into the European Union, right? So hence you have these very strange utterances by, you know, the Front National in France, or even UKIP in Great Britain, right, where it turns out that Putin is a much admired figure. And so you wonder, like, how exactly can you be a French or an English nationalist, you know, if what you're doing is executing Russian foreign policy? Rhetorical question. But it seems like, you know, if you're going to be a real nationalist, like, be a nationalist, right? You know, if you're going to do it, do it. Like, don't say, oh yes, let's wait for like the Russian line, and that, you know, be a nationalist, for crying out loud. Okay, so But anyway, there's a serious point here, which is that Russia is supporting populism, nationalism, separatism against the European Union, right? So you remember the Scottish referendum? Did you notice that Russia filed an official protest claiming that the referendum actually passed, right? They're in favor of separatism. They want things to fall apart. When Russia launched its second big commercial channel in the US, which is called Sputnik, it launched it under the fanfare of 2015, the year of separatism, right? You know, which maybe it will be, but it seems like there's a certain agenda there, right? Okay, so the highest level, and this moves us closer to civil society, so one more thing about making things fall apart. So they're trying to make the European Union fall apart, and obviously they're trying to make the Ukrainian state fall apart, right? I mean, this war to bleed Ukraine dry is a war to weaken the Ukrainian state. And the irony of it, I mean, as I pointed out a year ago, is that when I predicted that Russia would invade Ukraine, and everyone said I was crazy, the irony of it is that it's harder than Russia thinks to invade Ukraine, right? Because whatever you think about the Ukrainian state, it does exist. Whatever you think about the Ukrainian nation, it does exist, right? So there is more resistance than they were expecting. And because there's more resistance than they were expecting, they have to keep fighting. And the longer they fight, the longer Russia fights, the more this war disproves their own assumptions about why they're fighting it, and the more it puts the regime that started the war into a corner. But in any event, they're trying to make the European Union fall apart, the Ukrainian state, and this brings us to civil society, right? Civil society is one of the things that you're trying to make fall apart. Okay, I'll return to that. The next level, and maybe the intellectually most interesting level, and again, like the thing which I think requires the most like serious attention and respect, is the philosophy. The applied postmodernism of the philosophy. So the way that Russian organs of propaganda present the war is extremely interesting, right? It's much more sophisticated, you know, than like the silly Western propaganda networks. It's much more sophisticated even than the Germans in the 1930s, and that's a claim that I make after some hesitation. They do a couple of things which fit into our postmodern moment and therefore work on us. And the reason they work on us, of course, is that we are like Russians and Russians are like us. We're not really that different, okay? We're very much in the same historical moment. So what they do, one of the things they do is cacophony, so many voices at the same time, right? So if you want to know like who downed, you know, MH17, the Malaysian air flight, you know, it was a Russian brigade based in Kursk. It's not actually that tricky. But the way you make it tricky is you have a talk show and you invite someone in and they say, well, it was a Ukrainian fighter jet. And then you invite someone else in and they say, well, it was the Americans. And you invite someone else in and they say, the Malaysian air flight that went down in Ukraine was actually the same flight as disappeared over the Pacific Ocean. And it was already filled with corpses by the CIA before it was launched. No, that was reported. You're not paying enough attention to the Russian press. There are important things you don't know. So you report all these different versions, and among them you report the version that maybe, you know, the separatists shot it down, which is not actually true, that it was the Russian armed forces. But you report a whole bunch of different versions. And see, now I've basically done, you know, I've done Russian television's work because now you're going to go home and you're going to say, hey, Professor Snyder said a Ukrainian fighter jet shot it down, right? Because as soon as you loose these versions upon the world, what you do is you create a kind of confusion, right? And that's deliberate. When something happens that's really bad, right? Like that Russian forces or forces backed by Russia, it's now more or less been demonstrated it was Russian forces. But if something very bad happens, you don't deny it, right? You don't stand up and say, no, it wasn't us. You let loose a whole lot of other versions, and then at the end of the day, no one's really sure. And that's all you have to aim for, that no one's really sure. The second thing, which is, you know, they've done amazingly well, is political marketing. Okay, which I admit it, they learned this from us. You know, RT is just like Fox News on speed. And the political marketing often came from Americans, okay? Like, guilty. But they do it very well. Okay, so what are the two forms of political marketing? The first is you play to the conservative right. And the way that the Russians play the conservative right is this whole story about decadence. Decadence, family values, conservative values, true Christian civilization, right? Which are, you know, supposedly safeguarded by Russia, even though if you look at like out of wedlock births and abortion rates and any like actual empirical data, Russia is not exactly, I mean, much as I like the place, it's not exactly the safe place for conservative values in practice. I mean, even by Czech standards, okay, it's not. Speaking of another place where people talk about conservative family values, and you just have to sort of shake your head. So to the right, they have this story, right? Conservative values, civilizations, and then for the left, they have another story. The story for the left is the Ukrainians are fascists. They're all fascists. Bandera, 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 right? And by the way, they're all fascists. And that's for the left, right? And obviously, the two stories are contradictory, you know. But they target them, and it works very well. And so you get these weird coalitions of people who think that the Russian invasion of Ukraine is okay, people who presumably wouldn't agree with each other on other things. So the political marketing is the second part of the effective postmodernism of all this. Now, where does this leave us with respect to civil society? What I've tried to do is give you a sense of how Ukraine and Russia are alike and different, both of which are really important. What happened on the Maidan, what that had to do with civil society, and what the reaction, the Russian reaction to Maidan has to do with civil society, which I think is rather a lot. And let me try to be clear now in a kind of conceptual way about what it means. So the three big conclusions. The first is the civil society, I think, I mean, and there are people here who have thought about this much more than me, but I think one of the important aspects of civil society is the self-emancipation part, right? The part where you decide who you are, right? The part where you say, even though the state is like this, and even though, you know, all my friends are doing this other thing, I'm going to do what I decide to do. The sort of self-emancipation, the self-defining part. Right, and then as you do that, maybe you meet other people and you play in a rock band, or you meet other people and you brew beer or whatever it might be. But it's that choice to do your own thing. Now, this I think is very serious because it runs up against, in the context of the Russian-Ukrainian war, it runs up against some of the arguments that have been made on the Russian side, which strike me as worth thinking about really seriously. If you say, right, that there is a Ruski Mir, that there's a world of Russian civilization, and in some way everyone who speaks Russian, you know, or who even pronounces the phrase Ruski Mir, that everyone who does this somehow belongs to civilization, whether they know it or not, right? Okay, that's like a nice argument to have in a cafe. Is there a Ruski Mir? Is there not a Ruski Mir? But it actually has serious political, and I would even say existential implications. Because if I can say, right, I believe in Ruski Mir, and then I can look out at you and say, whoever speaks Russian out there, oh, yeah, you belong to the civilization too. I'm taking away your right to define who you are, right? The argument is even clearer in the case of Novorossiya, right? Where Putin has argued that, you know, part of Ukraine was historically part of the Russian Empire, therefore those people are Russian, therefore they should be in Russia, et cetera, et cetera. These are ethnic arguments. And here we see the difference between ethnicity and civic identification, which is really, really, really important, right? It's not just something that you learn like the first semester of your ethnic, you know, of your transition course or whatever. It's really, really, it's a fundamental difference. Because if I'm allowed to say that this is new Russia and these people are Russians because they speak Russian, then I am taking away their right to define who they are, right? I mean, just to, you know, if I'm allowed to look at Canada and say, well, those people speak English, therefore they're American, you know, why don't we just sort of roll on in? I'm making an ethnic argument. And you see how absurd it is on that example, right? And it's absurd on any example. There's a difference between civic and ethnic identity. And the difference is that ethnic identity allows power claims from far away, right? And this is an example which every Czech should by now have recognized because it is the example of 1938. If I say that there's Novorossiya, I'm making exactly the same move as if I said there was Sudetenland. By the way, Sudetenland did not exist until Hitler invented it, right? You probably like think it exists, but it didn't. Sudetenland was an invented region drawn out on the map, you know, to include the Škoda Works, for example, right? It was drawn on a map to include the things the Germans wanted. It was an invented category, just like Novorossiya is an invented category, based upon an ethnic argument, right? So these are the things which break up states, which brings me to the next point that I wanted to make, the second conceptual conclusion. It's about the state. So it seems to me that, you know, civil society is about the relationship between the individual and the state. And the one thing that we can be sure about the minimal claim on behalf of civil society is that this is a relationship that we get to negotiate, right? That the state doesn't decide what it's all about any more than the individual decides what it's all about. But the other thing that we can say about the individual and the state as we contemplate this particular situation that we have is that if there is no state, there isn't going to be civil society, right? If you, I don't know how many of you have been spending much time in Ukraine now. I mean, it's certainly the case that there's really interesting civil society activity going on. If the people who are helping the refugees from Donetsk and Crimea and so on are usually small people working in small organizations. That said, in the places where state structures have been wiped out, like in the Donbas, I'm afraid that you can't really speak of civil society there. I mean, let me put it a different way. In the 1990s, Americans had a certain fantastic in the sense of fantasy, reading of Václav Havel, which I'm afraid Václav Havel also shared, which was that, or at least he allowed himself to sort of be co-opted by us, and that was, if you believe the civil society thing, what you're really saying is no state is good. States are bad, no states are good. And that way, Havel got swept into our neoliberal whirlwind. And that, my friends, is clearly wrong. If there is no state, things go very bad very quickly, and then it's impossible to speak of civil society, right? And so when Russia manages to wipe out state structures in Donetsk and Luhansk, which it does, it is also destroying civil society. Because when gangsters of various kinds are running the streets, there is not civil society. A state can destroy civil society by being too strong. It can also destroy civil society by wiping out someone else's state structures, which is, another lesson here which is worth remembering. Civil society is a negotiation between individuals and states, which means you have to have individuals, but you also have to have states. The third and final remark that I want to make here is about trust. And this may be the question which bears most directly on the civil society tradition and on the way that the Maidan was carried out and on the Russian war. If you decide who you're going to be, especially in tradition in authoritarian conditions, and you do something with someone else, you're trusting them, right? There's a certain, there's what we would now call an offline technology here, right? There is human trust involved. There's the belief that the other person is not going to turn you into the authorities. There's the belief that he or she sincerely is interested in the same things that you're interested in, right? Civil society, at the smallest and most important level, kind of depends upon that. It depends upon trust. The Maidan obviously depended upon trust in this way, right? The people who I know who were on the Maidan have what they call their Maidan friends. That is, people who they met in that particular situation to whom they would literally trust their lives and well-being in a moment of crisis, right? And these were very often friends that they didn't have before, people from different social milieu, people who they would not have met without that particular situation, right? That's a radical example of trust. Now, let's think about the last thing that I said about the Russian war, this postmodernism, the cacophony, the political marketing, right? Which we all have to sort of grow up and learn to deal with and resist. The ultimate point of these things is not to make you believe any particular version of the truth. That's not the point. That's very old-fashioned, right? That's so 20th century. That's done, right? No one is trying to make you believe in the final triumph of communism or fascism, as the case may be. No one is trying to make you believe in the final triumph of anything at this point. What people are trying to do is corrode your capacity to believe in anything, right? What Russian propaganda is doing is exporting Russian distrust in the media and the authorities to the rest of the world, right? So the Russians don't believe in their media. They don't believe their authorities. Right? They shouldn't. We shouldn't either in general, but what's corrosive and ultimately toxic is the presumptive belief that everything which comes in from the media is part of some kind of scam, right? And that's what all of this is aiming for. It's aiming for the erosion of belief in any kind of authority or, to be a little bit philosophical about it, in truth. Right? If you can't trust anyone to tell you the truth, if you really believe that what happened, for example, on the Maidan was not a lot of people who trusted each other in a life or death situation, but a CIA plot, which was somehow organized at long distance, if you really believe that's what happened, then you don't believe in trust, or you don't believe that it matters, right? And once you've made that move, you're in the world of conspiracy theories, where everything happens at long distance. It's all part of some design by unseen forces, whatever they might be, gay, fascist, Jewish, gay, fascist, whatever they turn out to be. No, I mean, there are. That's a good example of political marketing, right? There's a Russian version which says that Ukrainians are all anti-Semitic, and there's also a version which says that Ukraine itself is a Jewish plot, right? Depending upon who you're aiming for, both versions are out there. So, so if you stop trust, if you can't trust, this is really important. It has to do with like this whole distinction between the offline world and the online world. If you can't trust anyone because you don't believe in truth, you know, or you don't believe in truth, therefore, how could you trust anyone? Because there's no truth anyway. That means that everyone is just somehow a puppet of some conspiracy or another. Then civil society is impossible, right? And this seems to me to be the ultimate thing which is at stake. You know, and it's interesting. I mean, I think it gives us a reason to think about civil society again, and it's important. I think it's the most important thing which is happening. I think it's more important than Ukraine. I think it's more important even than Europe. This question about how politics actually functions. Does politics happen because people between the level of the state and the individual are able to trust each other enough to form organizations? Or does politics happen because civil society has ceases to exist? Which is the very last thing I want to say. The thing about civil society, like so many things, it does exist in the world. I mean, it is out there. But if you choose not to believe in it, you can make it go away. Like so many things, it does exist. So, you know, anyone who tells you it doesn't exist is a little bit too cynical, or they have a purpose in saying so. But if you take the view that it doesn't exist, you can make it go away. You can break down trust. It can be done. It has been done before. It's been done in this part of the world before, and not so terribly long ago. Okay, thank you very much.
What measures can be taken to counter Russian propaganda in Eastern Europe and the EU?
Yeah, it's really beyond my area of specialization. I think the one thing that historians and philosophers and students of literature can do is to critically analyze the propaganda and try to create some categories for understanding it. So if you'll notice, I didn't concentrate so much on saying what was right and what was wrong, because in a way that's beside the point, right? I mean, a lot of the claims are obviously wrong. Like, it's wrong that Ukrainians are all fascists. It's wrong that Ukrainians aren't a nation. By the way, I mean, one of the things which is characteristic about the propaganda, which is worth thinking about, and which shows us how deep of a challenge it is that it doesn't observe the Aristotelian principle of non-contradiction, right? So on the one hand, Ukrainians are not a nation. On the other hand, they're all nationalists. On the one hand, there's no Ukrainian state. On the other hand, it represses Russian speakers, right? On the one hand, there's no Ukrainian language. On the other hand, Russians are being forced to speak Ukrainian, right? You know, on the one hand, we're defending the world from fascism. On the other hand, we're supporting fascists. So they don't bother to observe the principle of non-contradiction. And what's striking to me is how rarely it is that we notice that, right? Like, you wouldn't be laughing if you had already noticed this, I'm sort of supposing. Like, and this is all, maybe you have, sorry, I'm probably underestimating you, but this has all been out in the world for a year. Like, these contradictions have been there from the very beginning. And one of the things which is striking is how easy it seems to be to get away with contradicting yourself and how that doesn't matter. So one of the things that scholars can do is just like categorize these things, like, for example, principle of non-contradiction. Do they follow the principle of non-contradiction? No, they don't, you know. And then as a scholar, I just say, hey, that's interesting. You know, I don't say what exactly you do to respond to it. I've got a general gut feeling about all of this, and I'm gonna answer this question the same way that I answer my Ukrainian friends, because they ask this a lot. My gut feeling about this is that it's important not to do the same thing. That if you do the same thing, you're losing, not winning. Because if you decide that your media is just going to be the same kind of postmodern cacophony, then you lose. I mean, because A, like, I don't think anybody's ever going to be as good at this as the Russians are, for one thing. But B, it doesn't really matter what is said. But what matters is the question of truth, or the question of belief in the possibility of truth, or the question of, to put it more modestly and precisely, the question of the belief in journalism. Since that's what the stakes really are, if you stop practicing journalism yourself and start doing the same thing, I think you lose rather than winning. So I don't think you can do counter-propaganda against this in the same way that the propaganda is done, because you end up just being part of the problem. And I say this with great humility, because I think we are part of the problem. I mean, I think in a way, you know, what ERTE shows us, what Russia Today shows us, is the logical implication of Fox News. It shows us the logical development of the idea that news is just entertainment, people just have opinions, and we're just going to pick the people whose opinions we like and pretend to balance it with other opinions and claim that we're fair and balanced, right? It is the logical development of that. I mean, right down to the technique, you know? So we have a certain amount of responsibility for this. And so when we ask, like, what it is, how can we respond? One of the ways we can respond is we can contemplate the development of our own, you know, media culture, you know, or our own civilization, because it really, it's just an extreme version of a problem that we already have. Now, okay, much simpler answer, which I think is really interesting. So I spend a lot of time in Austria and Germany, and I spend a fair amount of time in Poland and, you know, the US sometimes. And one of the things that I'm struck by is the difference between countries which still have a live journalism culture and actually send correspondents and countries who don't, right? So the German debate about all of this has been wild. It's been all over the place. It's been heavily influenced by Russian propaganda. But the Germans have reporters. They have, you know, they have Die Zeit, they have the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, they have the Süddeutsche, and these newspapers actually send reporters to cover events in the Donbass. And it's not as though they all come back and say the same thing, but what they do is they give German readers a nuanced, you know, rich picture of events, as opposed to the crushing simplicity of propaganda stereotypes. And it turns out that makes all the difference in the world. Like, it's a very simple thing, like, send a journalist. I mean, I noticed something similar with the New York Times. Okay, so the New York Times, up until, I'm going to forget the exact date, but it's up until somewhere around December 6th, of 2013, was reporting on Ukraine from Moscow. Then they started reporting on Ukraine from Ukraine. And it's amazing how much difference that made, right? So one very simple answer to that question is not, you don't fight propaganda with propaganda, you can just fight it with journalism. Like, actually send foreign correspondents out and publish what they write, as opposed to your spin on what you've read from the internet. And
thank you. I will combine three questions. One is that it's really unusual to predict invasion so long time before, a couple of months, which was the case of the invasion and the prediction of Professor Snyder. So the question is where the possible next Putin steps might go. It's combined with the question of the journalist Petra Procházková, which is she's asking if Professor Snyder expects that one of the objectives of President Putin is also to reach the land corridor to Crimea in eastern Ukraine. And the third question is, how do you think it's better for Republic of Moldova to maintain its neutrality status, either try to join NATO as Georgia or Ukraine, or try to keep neutrality if the war is just nearby? Okay.
So on prediction, so it is the case, you can go back and look, I wrote an article for the New York Times which said that Russia was going to invade Ukraine. I tried to write it in much more strident language than they were willing to publish it. You know, and if they'd published the original version, it would have been an even better prediction, because I was trying to be very clear about it. The reason I was confident about that was that these myths about Ukraine and Russia really matter. So the things that Putin was saying in the lead up to all of this, that Ukraine and Russia are one nation, for example, these things are really problematic, not just because they're not true, but because they can lead you to make bad policy. So if you really don't think there are Ukrainians, and if you really tend to think, as unfortunately I think Putin does, that Russian speakers really are Russians and there was a broad sentiment in Ukraine to join Russia, et cetera, then you can make strategic mistakes, Right, and the invasion of Ukraine was a strategic mistake. I mean, this was not the subject of my lecture, but I think this was a huge strategic mistake for Russia. I think it may be the biggest foreign policy blunder in modern Russian history, because it forces Russia away from the West, and the power that Russia has is its ability to balance between the West and China, and it's basically punted that, it's sacrificed that for no reason whatsoever. I mean, for Crimea, right? That doesn't really make any sense. So. And I mean, of course, you know, everyone's very, very, very interested and excited not to have that straightforward discussion about Russian strategic gains, because of course they're fighting a war and they can't lose the war and et cetera. But I just, and this is another thing I said right at the beginning, I don't see how this can work for Russian strategy. I don't see why it's in their interest to throw themselves into the arms of the Chinese. China, on the other hand, thinks this is a great Russian policy. I don't know how much people have been tracking this point, right? But this is not, I realize I'm going away from the question. I will get back to Moldova. But this really is a global event in which Beijing is arguably the only winner, the one and only winner. America is obviously losing, you know, in terms of prestige. You know, we give a State of Union address and we talk about how great our policy is and you look ridiculous. The European Union is obviously losing. You're under attack. You know, you've done a much better job of formulating policy than might have been expected, right? But the collapse of the Russian economy hurts you. The collapse of the Ukrainian economy hurts you. This is not a win for the European Union. Ukraine is obviously losing, right? It's losing people. It's got more than a million refugees, internal and external. Russia is losing, right? I mean, the loss in the Russian economy is mostly due to oil prices, which is has nothing to do with the war. That is a Saudi policy directed against the U.S., in which Russia is just completely a casualty on the side. It's irrelevant to anyone's policy. But the Russians are clearly losing too, right? All these people are losing. We've sort of combined to lose, all of us. The only people who are winning are the Chinese. And interestingly, because they're much better diplomats than both the Americans and the Russians, they're very good at not saying so, right? I mean, American diplomacy consists, like, we this is why I'm never gonna get a job in the State Department, but we have a policy, and then we jump up, we have some really mild policy, and then we jump up and down about how it's decisive and it's turned the tide and we've really won, you know. It's just ridiculous. And the Russians do the same thing, right? We took Crimea. Oh, come on. Right? Both the Americans and the Russians make a huge deal for domestic audiences, right, about these really kind of irrelevant things. Whereas the Chinese have made huge gains, right? They've forced Russia to come to Beijing to negotiate a natural gas deal on ridiculously low prices. And at the same time, they have an interest in Ukraine. And the interest in Ukraine is agricultural land, which apparently they have, of which they have something like 9% on leases. Now, why is that important? Because land is one of the things that China doesn't have. Fertile agricultural land, and a lease in Ukraine, a contract in Ukraine, is only enforceable if Ukraine signs its association agreement. So the Chinese are getting everything out of this. Ukraine has signed an association agreement, and the Russians have managed to get themselves into war over Ukraine. So Beijing is winning. Okay, and what's interesting about this, again, is that they don't say anything because they're smart, right? Unlike, you know, they're smart. They're winning this thing in every possible way, and they're smart. Okay, now I really have gotten away from the question, which was...
land corridor to
Crimea. Yeah, so land corridor to Moldova. Okay, so Putin's next moves and the land corridor to Crimea. Putin's next moves are really hard to plot. Because it's not, I don't think he's following a grand plan, right? I mean, that the war was going to happen and be a mistake, that was a tactical blunder, and I say it's a level of tactics because the whole reason it happened was the reason it was a blunder. They thought it was going to be easy. And Crimea was easy, and in a sense, that was part of the tragedy, because if Crimea had been harder, they probably wouldn't have decided to mess around in Donbass. But their whole mistake was that it was going to be easy. It was just everything was going to fall into their hands, which hasn't turned out to be true. I don't think there's a grand Russian strategy here in the territorial sense. I think the grand Russian strategy is what I've described. It's a philosophical strategy. You're relatively weak. You try to make everyone else relatively weaker. That is the long-term plan. And frankly, that's smart enough, and that's enough for us to think about. That's enough for us to deal with. So Putin's next moves, I think in a way we kind of fall into a trap when we try to get inside Putin's mind. right? I think that's a kind of trap, because we don't really know, because he doesn't really know, it's impossible to know. What we can try to do is analyze what the overall pattern is, and the overall pattern is they're trying to make things fall apart. You know, your strength in Europe is you have various kinds of connections, civil societies, states, the European Union. That's your strength, it's great, you know? But the Russians don't have that. They've got different things. They have natural resources. They've got certain parts of a central state that function very well. They're trying to use their natural resources and the parts of their state that function well, the secret services, what was the other part? Oh, the army. They're trying to use those parts to make the rest of you weaker. And they're doing a pretty good job. Oh, propaganda, that's the other thing. And they're trying to use those things to make you weaker. That's fundamentally what's going on. So, I mean, I won't try to dodge the question. No, the maps of Novorossiya go down. I mean, I don't know if you read the Separatist Press, right? But the Separatist Press in the Donbass publishes maps of what Novorossiya is, and it goes down and it covers the Black Sea, right? They say that what they're fighting for is that corridor down to the Black Sea, which is important because it's one more thing that would make the Ukrainian state weaker. Because the Ukrainian state, as I mentioned before, is an important agricultural country. It's the third or fourth most important exporter of agricultural goods in the world, right? And then, of course, exports on boats from the Black Sea. So if you can cut them off completely from the Black Sea, it's not like you're really going to build a new state down there, but what you are going to do is hurt the Ukrainian state. So yes, I think that's what they're going for. The fighting around Mariupol suggests that that's what they're going for. Moldova is the idea is to link up with Transnistria, as everybody knows, right? If that's the two questions are the same question. So what Moldovans have to think about is what you do when the Russian plan is to link up with Transnistria. I don't have the answer for you, but I think that's the problem.
Yep. What do you say about the recent march of fascists in Kiev and about the information that there are plenty of the paid fighters from a neo-Nazist and fascist groups from USA and EU are fighting in the eastern Ukraine?
Okay, so let me give a list of the people who are fighting in eastern Ukraine, right? According to the Russian media, the Polish army, Blackwater, a private American company, let's see, who else is supposed to be there? Oh, the NATO Foreign Legion. Did you know there was a NATO Foreign Legion? The NATO Foreign Legion is fighting in eastern Ukraine. So from the beginning of this war, the whole idea is to present it as though it's not, you know, not a Russian attack on Ukrainian territory, but instead some kind of cataclysmic, apocalyptic confrontation of the Russian forces of good against the worldwide conspiracy led by the Americans, which in the nastier version is led by the Jews, right? That's the whole idea, to present it as the Russians defending themselves against this worldwide conspiracy, which is capable of throwing fascists from all over the world against the poor beleaguered Russian army. This is fundamentally not what is happening. Fundamentally, what is happening is that you have Russian regular and irregular forces without whom the separatists in the Donbass would not be capable of carrying out offensive operations and would not be capable of grounding the Ukrainian Air Force. Okay? I mean, not to get all military on you, but the Ukrainian Air Force is grounded because Russian troops are capable of shooting down, and occasionally they make a little mistake and shoot down a civilian plane, but they're capable of shooting down the Ukrainian Air Force, which means that the Ukrainians don't have air superiority, which means that the Russians and their friends can mount this kind of offensive that they're mounting now. This has nothing to do with fascists or not fascists. This is in a way a pretty conventional military conflict. Now, if you want to ask about who the people who are fighting are, you know, not all of them are very nice people. The first leader of the Donetsk Republic, the separatist republic, was a Nazi, and that's just not me calling him a name. He belonged to a Nazi organization. The Russians from their side had a hard time motivating the civilian population, so a lot of the people they ended up recruiting for the separatist forces, not most of them, but a lot of them, were people from the Russian nationalist right. You know, a lot of the Russians who die in combat have very interesting tattoos, right? So it's there are nasty people fighting this war. On the Ukrainian side, you have the Ukrainian armed forces. You also have a number of battalions, which I think is an inherently worrying development, and it's evidence of the fundamental problem in Ukraine, which is the weak state. If you're a normal state, you have an army and you don't have to fight a war with battalions. One of the reasons they're not a normal state is because Yanukovych deliberately reduced the army, the size of the army, so it couldn't defend itself against Russia. But this is part of a larger Ukrainian syndrome, and it's important to see it that way. Among these battalions, there are definitely some people who are on the far right. Definitely some people who are on the far right, and I think that's a real problem, and I think the state should try to rein them in. But that said, you know, I mean, this is, so I'm trying to be empirical and like be the kind of journalist I think people should be. That said, like, to look at those guys and say what's happening is like Russia fighting the forces of world fascism is utterly ridiculous.
Thank you. There's a question on President Poroshenko. Who is Poroshenko? How you see his prospects? Is he an oligarch? Probably. The question is if it's about his economic interest, or is he a real politician?
So, I mean, obviously, I don't know the answers to those questions because I'm not Poroshenko's best friend. So let me try to answer it in a broader way, which I hope is more interesting. The breakthrough that has to happen in Ukraine, the breakthrough that the Maidan was all about, was from oligarchical pluralism into real pluralism, right? Pluralism without the oligarchical modification. And of course, oligarchical is a very important qualification, right? Oligarchical pluralism is something very different. So, you know, in American history, in the late 19th century, we had something very much like oligarchical pluralism. It can happen, you know, you can get over it. And what the Maidan was about, and in this way, the Maidan, you know, this is something which gets totally lost in the discussion, and I've just done my part by calling it bourgeois, but the Maidan was a left-wing revolution in the fundamental sense that it was against the concentration of wealth and power in the hands of the few, and for the distribution of wealth and power by way of the rule of law to the many. In that sense, you know, all these crazy discussions of like a fascism and fascists to the side, it was fundamentally a left-wing movement. And this, by the way, is a point which seems to have been lost on the entire world, right? I mean, this is one of the ways that the political marketing worked, because it took us 6 months to get over this. We spent 6 months talking about like, is everyone in the Maidan, are they all fascists? Yes or no? You know, as though that were the question, right? Are they all Martians? Yes or no? Are they all vegetarians? Yes or no? Are they all feminists? Yes or no? You know, are they all my left-wing anarchist friends? Not all of them, a lot of them. You know, so yes or no. But the whole point is to reduce the discussion to some ridiculous thing, and then that means that you don't observe the reality. That was stage one. Stage two, by the way, was, are they all paid agents of the Americans? Yes or no? Paid agents of the Americans? Yes. And that changes the subject from what actually is going on. Sorry, what was the question?
The question was about Poroshenko.
Right. So what has to happen in Ukraine, and what the Maidan was about, right? The Maidan was not fundamentally about Russia. It was not fundamentally about Russia any more than the Prague Spring was about Russia, right? It was not, the Prague Spring was not about Russia. It was not about offending Leonid Brezhnev, right? That was not what it was about. The Maidan was not about Russia either. It was about internal reform, okay? And so what was supposed to happen, as it were, was that the oligarch who was in charge, Yanukovych, was supposed to fall, and then you would have real democratic elections, and then maybe you would have the rule of law. So here comes my true left-wing self. What actually happened was a counter-revolution, okay? Because, and this is a classical situation, when you're invaded from abroad, it is very hard to be left-wing reformers. It's very hard. When Ukraine was invaded, what did they do? They call in, you know, and this is where I like lose all my invitations to my, you know, Oligarchs International. You call in Taruta to be the governor of Donetsk, right? You call in I'm blanking on his name, to be governor of Dnipropetrovsk, right? And Kolomeisky, thank you. You call in Kolomeisky to be governor of Dnipropetrovsk, right? And you elect Poroshenko president. What is that? That is a counter-revolution, because these are actually the guys who you were trying to get rid of in the first place. But you have to do it, because going back to the battalion question in the weak state, because these are the people who can actually defend against a Russian invasion when the state can't. And that was the calculation. So the Russian invasion brought, in effect, a kind of counter-revolution in Ukraine, and it meant that the Maidan couldn't go where the Maidan was supposed to go. The Maidan was not supposed to go against Russia. It didn't have anything to do with Russia. It was supposed to go against oligarchy, and the Russian invasion helped the oligarchs and pushed back change in Ukraine quite significantly. It's functioned objectively as a counter-revolutionary force. So Poroshenko, so if you're going to break through from, I'll just say this very generally, from oligarchical pluralism to pluralism, some oligarch at some point is going to have to do this for you. I mean, in America, it was the Taft family, but some oligarch at some point is going to have to make decisions and take some hits and lose some money, you know, and make some sacrifices. Whether that's going to be Poroshenko or not, I don't yet know.
Thank you. There is three questions which are about, for a certain extent, about sanctions and our reaction. So what do you think of anti-Russian sanctions? Should they continue? How far we will be waiting and observing sovereignty of the situation? How much time it will take us to take a response, economic, political, military, or otherwise? And the third question, is the US moving towards a policy of being stronger on the problem in eastern Ukraine? Is the EU capable of enough firm response if needed? So it's basically about us and Russia.
Okay, so sanctions. I thought and continue to think that sanctions were a good idea, not so much because of what they do for Russia, but because they demonstrated the capacity of the European Union, most importantly the European Union, to have a policy of some kind. If you didn't have sanctions, what exactly would you have, right? I mean, if what I'm saying is remotely true and you're facing an existential threat, if you didn't have sanctions, what would your response be, right? Nothing. There is no EU foreign legion, unfortunately. I mean, I think one of the things the European Union should have is a military academy. So it's not always NATO, right? You should have a military academy, you should have your own officers, you should have one rapid reaction force. If the EU had one rapid reaction force of 20,000 men and women in its own officer corps, this wouldn't have happened, just by the way. 20,000 is all it would have taken. There are only 50 or 70,000 people in the Russian army who can fight. Right, it's not like it's a huge, overwhelming force. You just don't have any army at all, right? None. So sanctions. You have to have sanctions because it demonstrated that you're going to react in some way. Without sanctions, you have no policy since you don't have an army. Without an army, you can't have foreign policy. I mean, sorry to get all 19th century on you, but since you don't have an army, all you can have is an economic foreign policy. And so I think it was very important at the level of morality and at the level of European identity to have some kind of policy that you could agree upon. And all now taking, you know, regardless of all the mockery that I just unfortunately unleashed upon you, having that policy was actually very impressive. I thought the discussion that led to that policy was very impressive, and I thought that the European solidarity that is involved and the willingness of certain sectors of the European economy, especially German ones, to take a loss has been very impressive, much more impressive than anything on the American side, right? I mean, it's easier for us to have sanctions because we are just much less invested in Russia. We matter a lot less, and therefore it's easier for us to have more aggressive sanctions. So I think they matter just because they, not so much because of what they do in Russia, although they do something, but because of what they demonstrate about the European Union. There's some sign that the European Union exists. As far as like when is policy going to turn the corner, when are Americans and Canadians going to get more involved and so on, I mean, I have this idea that this is a war in which there are only losers, as I've already sort of said. I think Russia's going to lose this war. You know, not because anyone's going to fight against them, but because it was doomed from the start. There's no strategic goal. You know, the number of Russians who can die in Ukraine, I think, is pretty constrained. How many mortal casualties were there in the Afghan war, right? 16,000, 16,500, which is, by the way, a quarter as much as the U.S. took in Vietnam. And that was already a huge problem for the Soviet Union. Russia is not the Soviet Union. I don't think they can take 16,000 mortal casualties. They've already taken a few thousand, right? There are already mothers' organizations. This is a constraint, which I think is much more important than the constraint of sanctions. It's a domestic political restraint. There are only so many sons of Russian mothers who can die. The way that they've avoided this thus far, you know, as far as they can, is sending in people who don't have mothers. No, I mean, that has no. I mean, this is like when you're trying to understand why they send in Chechens and why not that Chechens don't have mothers, you know, but the reason why they're sending in Chechen mercenaries, you know, people who are disconnected from normal Russian society, is that they're trying to avoid the Russian political response, right? If Chechens die in Ukraine, as many have, by the way, some of them on the Ukrainian side, if Chechens die in Ukraine, there's not going to be a Russian political response, right? No one is going to get too upset about that, given Russian attitudes towards Chechens. So, but when Russian regular troops, and also, a lot of this is interesting too, a lot of the fighting in Ukraine, I think this is no coincidence, is being done by Russian men who are veterans who are in their 40s, right? And literally people who don't have mothers, right? Literally people who don't have mothers, as opposed to regular, okay, they had them at some point, you take my point, that these are people who are, they're not 19-year-old conscripts whose mothers are gonna form organizations, right? Which has already been happening, right? And those and the mothers who have tried to form those organizations have already attracted the attention of the Russian state. So I see this as a war which no one can lose. I don't think no one can win. I don't think the American response is gonna be decisive, judging from present trends. I think, you know, it would be pretty easy for America or Europe to win this war if they really wanted to. But I don't think that's what's going to happen. I think Russia's going to lose without anybody winning. And in a way, that's the worst possible outcome for the regime that chose to fight this war. Because they're not going to be able to say, we lost to America. They're going to have to say, we lost to Ukraine, which is just about the most difficult thing for a Russian political leader. It's inconceivable that a Russian political leader could say that. And yet, I think it's what's going to happen. So so I don't think there's going to be a robust policy from the United States, but I still think that Russia's going to lose the war.
Two questions together. How does Russian civil society deal with the massive propaganda in the country, and why the rich nations do not put more emphasis on support of the civil society in the former Soviet Union countries?
So I'm not a student of Russian society and propaganda. I consume Russian propaganda, but I don't consume it with other Russians, and that makes it, you know, I consume it late at night, like with other sources around me, thousands of miles away, and not as a Russian. So it affects me differently than it affects Russians. It seems clear that certain parts of the propaganda resonate. So the idea that the Maidan was a CIA plot, and the idea that the war is not a Russian war, but in fact a war by decent Russian-speaking individuals against an oppressive Ukrainian state, those ideas seem to be pretty widespread in Russia, as far as I can tell. One reason that I think the latter one is widespread is opinion polling, which shows that most Russians support Putin's foreign policy, that most Russians oppose Russian military intervention in Ukraine, right? And you can only hold those views together if you don't understand that there is Russian military intervention in Ukraine. And I think, you know, as time, this is one of the reasons why I think this regime is in trouble. As time goes on, it's going to be harder and harder to keep that tension going, because most Russians don't actually want to fight a war against Ukraine. And if the news comes crashing in, as it eventually will, that is in fact what is actually happening, right? I think the regime is going to be in trouble. These things can't be, I mean, you can be really smart, you can have fantastic propaganda, but the one thing which transcends propaganda is death. Individual death, right? The death of a concrete individual with a name, the death of someone who's brought back, a Russian soldier who's brought back secretly because he was never supposed to be there, buried in an unmarked grave, whose mother can't find him. That transcends all of this, and the more of that you get, the bigger problem there's eventually going to be. So propaganda, it's clear that like the Russians are seeing this war differently than Ukrainians. So like one of the interesting questions, so there's this, you know, we, insofar as anyone still thinks there's a problem, like how are Russians different than Ukrainians, ask them what they think about the war, right? And then you'll see, right? Because you're not going to find that many Ukrainians who think that the Russian intervention was a good idea. Whereas you're going to find lots of Russians who think that Putin is pursuing sound foreign policy. So there is a clash there, and this is interesting. Between Russians and Ukrainians, the clash is much greater than between Russians and Germans, or even Russians and Americans, right? Because Americans will often shrug their shoulders and say, well, yeah, Crimea, maybe it really was Russian, right? Ukrainians aren't going to say that, right? So the clash between Ukrainians and Russians about the war is very sharp. And interestingly, with the exception of a little zone in the Donbass, no one in Ukraine really seems to be buying Russian propaganda at this point, whereas the rest of us are. And why is that? Not because they're so smart because they're Ukrainian, but because they actually have direct experience to compare to the propaganda. But in Russia, it's different, right? This is a point I made at the very beginning. There is not that much direct experience of the war yet. As time goes on, as with Vietnam, as with Afghanistan, as with any long war which is fought for unclear or mendacious purposes, the reality will begin to creep into the propaganda. You know, so Putin's approval ratings now are very high. I would note that they never got as high as President Bush's got during the first Iraq War. They never got that. No, the second Iraq War. They never got as high as, I think in either one actually. But my point is that in the United States, if you fight, you know, a war of aggression to destroy a state and, you know, doom yourself for the whole century, if you fight a stupid war of aggression, you lie about it and so on, you still get to be really popular for a while. Right? Putin may be able to sustain this burst of popularity from fighting, you know, a stupid war of aggression to destroy another state, you know, based on lies. He may be able to keep that going longer than you can in the United States, but I don't think indefinitely. I don't think this goes on forever, right? So maybe it goes on twice as long or three times as long. Bush's popularity was in the 90s for a while, and then he lost the next election. It was in the 90s. In 2003, and he still lost the next election, which is worth thinking about. Not that the political systems are the same, but I don't think that this approval can be kept up indefinitely. On why richer nations don't spend more on civil society, that's not, you know, okay. I don't know.
Yep. Again, internal Ukrainian questions, but I think it's interesting. If we forgot about Russian propaganda for the time, what is your opinion about using by Kiev's government fascistic symbolic, like using of swastics, flags, building the bandera statues? What do you think about returning of these authentic Hitler symbols in Europe, which has so sad experience with it?
Okay, so loaded question. So on the issue of Bandera and Shukevich, what I think about that is published and has been for a long time. One of the first things I wrote about as a scholar was Ukrainian nationalism, and in particular the mass murder of ethnic Poles in Volhynia in 1943. When the previous Ukrainian regime made Bandera and Shukevich heroes of Ukraine, I wrote an article criticizing that and mocking it on all possible grounds, and I referred to the two of them as fascists, which is what I believe. I don't think that Ukraine should be founding its tradition on these people. I don't have control over the situation, right? I'm not part of the American clique which pulls all the strings
in Ukraine. Is it a strong?
So I'm going to get to that. I just want to make it very clear that when I talk about Ukraine, I'm coming from a position of knowing Ukrainian language, having studied Ukrainian nationalism, having worked on the Holocaust and the role of Ukrainians in the Holocaust. So that's where I come from academically. Now, When one raises questions like this based upon false premises, then that has to be called out. The Ukrainian government does not use the swastika. The Ukrainian government does not use the swastika. That's just not true. Poroshenko is a chocolate manufacturer. Okay. There are more Jews in the Ukrainian government than there is in your government or my government. The proportion of Jews in the Maidan was larger than the general population. The portion of Jews killed on the Maidan was also larger than the general population. The Jewish community in Ukraine, in its majority, was in favor of the Maidan. I'm not going to say that all of them were, because that would be a ridiculous claim. It's never the case. But the idea that the current government in Ukraine uses the swastika or whatever is completely ridiculous. What I find interesting about this is the opposite trend. Okay, so in the traditional Ukrainian myth, I'll now go into a little bit of detail about something I only referred to. There was a conflict about the Second World War. The dominant view was the traditional Soviet one, which was that this was a great fatherland war, the Red Army was triumphant, and that was good. Then there was also a minority version, which had to do with the organization of Ukrainian nationalists and the Ukrainian insurgent army, which held that the Red Army was also an occupier, just like the German army was an occupier, and Ukrainian nationalists heroically fought against both. The problem with that myth was that they also killed a huge number of civilians, largely Poles, Well, actually, they killed more Ukrainians than Poles, probably. A lot of Ukrainians, a lot of Poles, a fair number of Jews as well. But there was a clash of myths in Ukraine, which was not something which you could see in Russia. What I was trying to say during the talk is that this has now essentially gone away, because the dominant political myth in Ukraine now doesn't have to do with either the Soviet version, which, by the way, is problematic, or the Ukrainian nationalist version. The dominant political myth in Ukraine has to do with the Maidan, the counter-revolution, and the war which is going on now, right? Which is basically a war in favor of a Ukraine which is oriented towards Europe. So if you want to buy the whole Ukraine equals fascist thing, then be prepared to buy the Europe equals fascist thing, right? Which is probably next on the table for you anyway, because that's the whole point of this propaganda. In any event, this refrain that like Ukraine has something to do with fascism has to be confronted with the basic facts, which is, for example, that the far right in free and fair parliamentary elections got fewer votes in Ukraine than in any major European country. Okay? Far fewer votes, as a matter of fact, than in places like France, far fewer than in the Netherlands, fewer than in Belgium. So the far right, about which the press made such a huge explosion of interest, when it comes to the ballot box, they were down around 1% and 2%, which are enviable results by European standards. The irony is that that happened on the same day as the European parliamentary elections. So if you just want to have a nice comparison, compare the Ukrainian outcome to the European outcome. The populist far right got much, much more in EU member states than it did in Ukraine. Okay, these are the basic things. And if you think the opposite, you know, just look at the electoral returns.
Thank you. There is a question: how the war in the eastern Ukraine might be stopped, or what will be the outcome? What will be the end? The split of Ukraine, or?
I don't know. I think, you know, there are already many important outcomes that are worth noting. I mean, rather than just looking to the future, let me just say some of the things that have already happened. The first is a fundamental split of Ukrainian and Russian public opinion, which I don't think is going to change. I tried to stress at the beginning that Ukrainians and Russians have an awful lot in common historically, and linguistically for that matter, and culturally. I mean, there are very few Ukrainians who consider themselves educated who are not in some sense children of Russian literature, right? So what has happened in the last year is a split between Ukrainian political and Russian culture, Ukrainian political culture and Russian political culture, which I think is a tremendously important event that didn't have to happen, right? It didn't have to happen. I mean, if Russia had played more of a long game with Ukraine, it could have sustained a certain amount of popularity and influence. By fighting a war, they've lost all that, and they've turned, you know, the Ukrainian intelligentsia and the Ukrainian population against Russia, which didn't have to happen. And when you consider that the connection between these two countries, you know, it doesn't go back 1,000 years, because you remember, like, 1,000 years ago, they were Vikings and Jews, but it goes back hundreds of years. And that connection, for all intents and purposes, has now been broken. That is a significant outcome of this war. Another significant outcome of this war are the more than million externally and internally displaced people, and the humanitarian crisis, which is ongoing in Luhansk and Donetsk regions, where people lack some combination, millions of people lack some combination of food, water, electricity, gas, and access to internet. There is a major humanitarian crisis going on right now in Europe, which we can't do much to stop, which Russia apparently doesn't want to stop. They're the only ones who could get things over the border. That is already an outcome of the war. So we're in the middle of a sort of Yugoslav scale event, right, in terms of human suffering. We just haven't quite put that name on it. This has all already happened. As far as the split of Ukraine, I mean, I don't know how this war is going to end up, you know, but one thing which is clear is that in terms of the political nation, this war has consolidated the Ukrainian political nation, right? This is the great irony of the whole thing. Nothing could have consolidated Ukrainian political identity more than an external war of aggression. Nothing. There's literally nothing. And nothing could have persuaded the majority of Ukrainians who think that Europe is a better choice than Russia more than Russia invading. Right? And so you had a consolidation around those basic convictions, which you didn't have before. NATO came up before. I mean, what's interesting about NATO, which I don't think is going to happen, incidentally, but what's interesting about it is that a majority of Ukrainians were always against NATO. I mean, that's why it was always a bad idea, or one of the reasons. A majority of Ukrainians was always against it, right? You can't, so it didn't make sense until now, right? Now a majority of Ukrainians are for NATO for the obvious reason that they've been invaded by a foreign power, right? So NATO has suddenly become very popular in Ukraine, which it wasn't before. How exactly this will turn out in terms of territory, that I can't say for sure. But one thing which I will say with some confidence is that the territorial projections, you know, that were being used in Moscow when this war started are not the ones that are going to match up to how the war is going to end.